BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
New Arts Alive features a guest artist who will share their work for a better understanding of today's art. Program moderator is James Carroll. During the live presentation, the home viewer has the opportunity to call and speak directly with the artist. New Arts Alive is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. New Arts Alive is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions. Good evening. I'm James Carroll, and with me, I have as my guest, Brent Collins. And Brent has a job of working on the project wall at the New Arts Program. And the project wall is different from most other kinds of exhibitions, because usually when you go to a museum or a gallery, you see an exhibition that the work is finalized and then it's put into the space. The project wall is that it's not, the work is not finished until the end of the project wall time, which is anywhere from 12 to 14 weeks. So what you're seeing is sort of a work in progress, or changes, or adaptations, or hopefully we see all kinds of thinking processes that go on and change and alter, and maybe we'll see a complete reverse in some way. Never know. And that's what's exciting about it. And Brent is just started this week with the wall, and it will be going until the Sunday, the 12th of July, and that is a Sunday, and that is the last day that it will be up. And at that time, we have a opening reception. In other words, it's a closing reception as opposed to an opening, and that is from 1 to 3 in the afternoon. So you can anticipate that as we're talking about it tonight, and as you go through and hear or read about him in the newspaper. Brent, I would like, if you could, state in a simple way what it is that I think, let's reverse it. What you're going to do with the wall, what you're thinking you're doing with the wall, and then also after that, I'll have another question for you.
Okay. The way that I approach the wall, first of all, when you came to me and asked me if I would like to participate with this, I thought it was an incredible opportunity for sort of the direction that my work has been going in for quite some time. I think I started the series that this continues, I think I started that in about 1999. So this series of works that I'm continuing here is called Propositions for the Construction of a Painting in the Post-Historical Age. It's a very long title, but what it basically is a series of works that take the possibilities that paintings could be, or possibilities of ways of making paintings today. So what I wanted to do with the wall was take it to a different place. I wanted to use the wall as, and I think your first description of that wall to me was kind of an open sketchbook. And I liked that idea. I liked the idea of being able to present the ideas that inspire me, the images that inspire me to make the things that I make. And I wanted to figure out a way that I could present a new way of looking at the art to the viewer. So what I did was I took all those thoughts, images, and ideas, and I'm placing them online in different social media outlets. On the wall currently, I have three QR codes that can be scanned with a mobile device that will automatically take you to one of those three outlets and let the viewer then kind of explore the art on their own terms.
Okay, now that is what you want to think about during the whole 12 weeks. Now then, if you could, very simply, you talked about it as far as your title of it is concerned.
Yes.
But does that explain the idea of the work that you have already done?
The work that's been completed right now.
Well, not necessarily there, but the work that's completed. In other words, we still have something going on.
We do. We have. You're talking about the digital portion of what I'm doing?
No.
Right. The digital portion are images, as I said, and ideas that inspire me to make the things that I make. Most of them are photographs. I'm not sure what else you want me to explain.
What are they photographs of?
Most of them, they're photographs of environments that are small. Smaller environments, textures, spaces that I find make nice paintings. Maybe not nice paintings. They make paintings that I find interesting. And so I capture those and I'm posting them for other people to sort of investigate and see and hopefully give me some kind of feedback, and I can create a type of dialogue then with the viewers through those social medias.
Okay, now if you can, would you give us a dialogue of maybe an image that could help?
You want to see?
Yes.
An image?
Yeah.
Sure.
We've got a number of them, but...
We've got quite a few images. This image is... There are things that I like about this. What I like to do is, when I walk through the world, I look at things. As an artist, I like to look to find the beauty in the everyday. When I make paintings, I tend to make paintings that follow the ideas of the things that I see. I don't make representational paintings when I make an object. I tend to make what we call abstract or non-representational paintings. They tend to be three-dimensional paintings. But what I try to do is I try to refer to the everyday.
Now the image that we have here, that is only a way to get in it. It's not a painting.
It's not a painting.
It's not a painting.
It's not a painting. It's a
photograph.
It's a photograph. Yep.
Of something that excites you.
Yep. Something
or stimulates
that
or
I saw and
you.
I thought, wow, that's, you know, that would make a really nice painting as it is. You want to look at another one?
Okay. Now, one of the things that you have on the wall to begin with.
Yes.
That piece on plywood,
mm-hmm.
What do you call that?
That's a QR code.
QR, is that the same thing as an apps?
Well, no, it,
what in apps is the results, isn't it?
Well, the app that's that you get on your phone is basically a small program. It's just like an application that you'd use on a computer. You click on it, and it does something for you. The QR code, and I have one here that I can show you. It's this one. This QR code is what I painted onto the plywood. I used this QR code as a reference. This one, and QR stands for quick response. Basically, these are an evolved UPC code. UPC codes were made to be scanned with a red laser that would read them. These were designed to be scanned with an imaging device like a camera. So these are meant to be sort of seen rather than scanned. And that's one of the reasons that I enjoy them, is because I can think of them in the same terms that I think of a painting, because they're meant to be seen.
In other words, can you make a code like this, mm-hmm. come up with an image like the photograph that we just saw?
I could, as long as I have that image somewhere on the internet. You can take that URL and plug it into a QR code generator, and it will generate a QR code that will take you to that image on the internet. So each of these could be stand-ins for the images that you see here. Instead of that, each of these QR codes will take you to, this one in particular takes you to an Instagram account that is uploading these images every day. So the images continually build up. There's going to be more images every day. And so the viewer can interact and continue to interact day after day after day with these.
Now, how do you're talking to a total layperson, totally,
okay.
Absolutely, the bottom essence. Now you say, how do you put it on there for them to try to, what do to get them? You use your scanner or your...
Yeah, you'd use, anybody who has a mobile device can download...
Oh, just a cell phone?
Yeah, a cell phone that they can download an app that will read these codes. And these codes, when it gets scanned with that phone, then it automatically links you to that place on the internet where those images are stored.
Now, what will come up when you scan this?
When you scan this, it's an Instagram profile. Instagram is a social media outlet that is image-driven.
Yeah.
Facebook is sort of image-driven. It has a lot of text involved. It's different than Twitter. Twitter is very text-oriented with a certain number of characters that you're allowed to use. Instagram starts with a picture and goes from there. And that's why I wanted that account to be sort of the home base of this, because it is about seeing, it is about art, it is about looking at
things. But it doesn't have any text to it.
It has some text, okay. Very minimal text. But
when you say minimal, what do you mean?
I mean, you can write text for each image that you put up.
You mean like a title or...?
You could put up a title, or you could use things like hashtags, like you'd use in Twitter, that if a user wants to find images that all have that same hashtag, they search that title or that hashtag, which is just a pound sign with a word after it. If they search that, all the images that have that hashtag attached to it will appear. So every one of these that I put up, I put that same hashtag on it so that you can search for it and find all of the images.
Okay, now, once when you have this on the internet,
mm-hmm.
and you have them able to have access to them, you're telling me that they can go, but what will they do with it beyond...
Hopefully.
Yes.
Hopefully they will share the images on other social media outlets. maybe they'll like the images. There's a button to click to say that I like this image. Or they could write comments if they want to. There's a space where you could comment on any of those pictures. So they can, the viewer can actually interact now with the images that I'm putting up there.
Okay, now if you are getting them to become involved in it with texts and maybe showing you illustrations that correspond with that or something else or comments that they make, how are you going to use that?
I'm not sure yet.
Oh.
I don't know how I'm going to use those. I've had a lot of ideas, and it really, I'm allowing this thing to sort of grow more organically. I've set up a set of criteria. These are the accounts that I'm going to use. These are the images that I'd like to use. So I've sort of reined myself in and said, this is what I'm going to present. And now I'm waiting to see how it gets dealt with in the public space. If people decide to interact with it, if they don't.
If you can get them excited enough to,
right.
to become involved with it.
And I want it to sort of grow organically. It's kind of an experiment. I've always been very interested in how the viewer interacts with art in the gallery. And now all I'm trying to do is sort of change where that interaction takes place. It can take place, they don't have to travel like a pilgrimage to a museum or a gallery to see the art now. They can go online, look at things that I'm doing, and have a different kind of interaction with that. And that's really where the thinking is with this project.
There, one of the things that always comes up about that I've never seen anything digitally that truly represents the piece, just like a slide or a photograph of a piece. It's not the piece.
Right. And with what I'm presenting, I'm not presenting anything at this point in the gallery that, I mean, I'm presenting paintings, and I have what I think is a very nice looking painting of a QR code and a couple of drawings of QR codes. And they're just sort of very minimally art objects. They're
well, they, you say it is, so consequently.
Well, that's right. But they,
it's
they have a purpose beyond sort of that enjoyment of viewing them. They want you to do something with them, almost physically, right? Because you have to take your phone and scan that thing, right? And then it takes you away from that object. It takes you somewhere else. It takes you somewhere where the object really does not exist. This digital world where it's just electrical impulses bouncing around.
I mean, so often you can, on your cell phone, you can be calling somebody, but you don't know really if you're talking, unless you know the voice very well. But I mean, generally speaking, all the time, the
that's
thing's
right.
going.
That's right. And that kind of interaction is really something that in the past few years, I've really gotten interested in. Where does that experience exist? How do you manage that kind of interaction in your day-to-day life? I mean, we're very used to interacting with objects. You know, you see a chair and you're walking, you go around the chair so you don't run into it.
But, or you move it.
Or you move it. I mean, you can do,
either,
there's multiple things you can do with
either
it.
Either or.
But we understand how to manage that experience. But when we start talking about, you know, digitizing our lives, you know, taking documents and putting them in the internet, on, you know, the cloud, wherever they happen to be, what happens to that thing? We transform it into something that's non-physical anymore. And sort of managing the experience of the non-physical has become very interesting to me. Because I feel like when you make a painting, when you make an object, you know, it's it it deals with a language that we're all very, very used to. And we're getting more used to sort of a digital language. But my question with the digital language is, how do we understand that object? Just like you were saying, this object, you know, if you take a picture of one of my paintings, which, as I stated, are generally very physical paintings, almost like little wall sculptures. If you take one picture of it, you don't understand that thing the same way you do as if you were standing in front of it.
The real thing.
The real object, right? So.
But in a way, are you trying to convert the other side where they won't be, the real object is not the real object, but the...
Well, the object has become the digital...
Out in space.
The digital thing out there that it doesn't matter if it's physical or not. Actually, it's probably better with what I'm trying to do with it right now that it isn't physical.
Let's see some other images.
Sure.
These are... So far, these are photographs, correct?
These are all photographs. Here's another one. This one's actually, some of these are older photographs that I took a while ago. Some of them are fresher and brand new. But I look at things like these kinds of spaces. Like, this is an erased chalkboard, and most people would walk past it, wouldn't give it a second thought. I like to look at these kinds of images. I like to think about how this relates to the language of modernist painting. I think that this could be a great found object for a museum.
Well, what you've done is selected because of how you have shown this chalkboard.
Right.
And also the outlet or the air duct or whatever else mm-hmm. is down there in the receptacle or the connection for connecting.
Right.
All of that, how you've juxtaposed it as far as the image is concerned. So it isn't just a chalkboard.
It's not just a chalkboard. It's that whole environment. And I've always been fascinated with the way that we as humans sort of arrange the world around us. And when I make a painting, I think about those things. I think about how does this relate to the objects of the real world. And I like to think about things like a painting being very fragile, meaning that it exists well in its sort of protected environment, say the gallery or the museum, that art space. And it exists in a way that we read it very differently than if I had placed one of my paintings in this room where this chalkboard was. It brings with it a different kind of interaction.
Okay, going back to your beginning somewhat, if you have the code, the diagram, geometrical
yep.
diagram, and can that be your images totally? That you have a person is going to have to take their cell phone and do it. In other words, there's no real element at the other end. But you say it will search for things.
Well, each of the QR codes
yes.
will take you to a specific place. Each one is made to take you to some specific place.
Okay, now the one that you have there, what is the specific place?
That will take you to the profile that I created on an app that's called Instagram that is where these images get uploaded
okay.
and posted.
Are any of the two images that we've seen now on that?
They both are.
They both are.
Both of them are.
Okay, so that they...
So you can view them here or you can go to Instagram. And the profile name is 7th.proposition. So you could go to Instagram and take a look at these images and explore them.
People working with computers have that understanding?
Yes. I think there's a lot of people who have Instagram accounts, they have Twitter accounts, they have Facebook accounts. Mm-hmm. There's a huge portion of the population. And what I'm doing is I'm using those sort of very basic, very easy to use applications to sort of push this forward. Originally, I had proposed in my own head to create my own website and run that website off of this exhibition. There's a couple of reasons that I didn't. Number one, I wanted it to be readily available. I wanted it to be as if these things are existing outside of the realm of art. I thought that if I created a website on its own, maybe some people wouldn't just happen upon it, which could still happen with this, instead of going to the gallery and getting into it that way.
Going to the gallery is a very controlled, it's almost an absolute controlled situation.
Right. I think that
this is somewhat too, but it's the environment that it's in is different.
Right. I feel like these things are more vulnerable sitting where they are now, rather than if I had protected them within my own constraints of a website. I feel like they're sort of in a public space. And we can kind of think about these social media outlets as public spaces, because they are out there and a lot of people are going through them and interacting with them. And I want these to be in that space, and I want them to be fragile in that way.
Let's see another image. Right.
And when I look at these, I can remember sort of when I saw them, when I decided to capture that image. I've obviously cropped things and made sort of an artistic image out of it. But I've always taken these kinds of photographs because I keep them as a record for myself to go back to when I'm making paintings. I can look back at them and
think about physical objects.
Paintings. Yeah, I'll call them physical objects rather than paintings from this point. But these physical objects that I can go back to this if I'm, you know, thinking about color combinations that I'm going to use on them, or the way one thing sits on top of another thing in these objects, I can go back and use these as reference. So this is very literally just an open sketchbook for people. It is where I'm recording ideas and inspirations, and I like that idea that I'm opening it up to the public to see.
Okay, now on your webpage, you have how many images right now on there? Three, did you say?
On the webpage? No, I think right now there's maybe 15.
15? All of them that you brought?
All of them are on here.
Yeah. All of them are on here.
I have all of them here.
Okay, I mean, I was just wondering if...
Here's another one.
Did you...
Very similar.
Maybe, I thought maybe we would see one that wasn't on there.
There are a little bit later. I have some images here of works hanging in a gallery, some of my physical objects. You want to look at those and talk about them, or...?
No, we can see some of these.
We can
go to those if you'd like.
Well, we can continue on with these. I mean, these are like snippets. I would consider them sketches. They're not finished works.
Sort of like cutouts or
something. They're cutouts,
right, exactly.
You're going through
different things and you like this.
Yeah, I like this and I like that, and I'll just narrow it down to this little view here. I like that. But that's exactly what they are. And I don't think that we can look at one of them and maybe critique it. I don't think they would stand up well to that. I think they stand up well to viewing them in the space that I'm presenting them, which is a lot of times on a mobile phone, you know, on that small screen, a very intimate relationship with the viewer, and just to kind of flip through them. A lot of people just swipe through them, look at those images, and you get kind of a feeling from the types of images that I'm selecting, sort of what the art is all about.
Okay, let's...
Here's another one of these buoys, which they're laying down now rather than hanging. But I was fascinated with these things when I saw them. They were...
In a boat, yeah, in a dock.
They were in a dock. They were actually in a gift shop. They were selling them. There were hundreds and hundreds of them. Each one was painted different, and I thought, boy, each one of these things is a beautiful painting. You know, I could take any one of these and hang it up in a gallery, and it would hold its own. It would talk about all of these experiences. It would work well just as a sort of an aesthetic object. They would work well, you know. They have this whole history behind them. But I didn't want to do that. I didn't want to buy them and hang them up. That's not what I wanted to do. I thought about how can I create an object that does the same thing, that doesn't necessarily have that same history to it. Because I'm not really interested in like a nautical history or anything like that. I'm not interested in telling those kinds of stories. I'm interested in telling stories about an object and how it relates to the world. Sort of a non-representational object, and how its aesthetics, how its materials relate to...
Well, these are definite objects, whereas the first image you had actually isn't an object. It was light coming in. And
it was...
It's temporal.
It's light in a space, and...
And it being temporal in that it can disappear just as quick as it appeared.
That's right, and...
These have a little more solidarity.
Right, well, these are certainly objects. That was more of a space, a feeling of light. And, you know, if you look at any paintings throughout history, light is a part of painting. And sometimes when I look at the world and I see the way light is falling across something, I say, you know what, that's this aesthetic experience that I want to capture. And that's what it was, more than anything with that, was just this kind of aesthetic experience that sort of took me by surprise. It was taken inside a movie theater, in the waiting area outside of a specific movie theater. And it just, I thought, wow, you know, who would have thought that sitting here on this bench waiting to get in to see a movie that I would have this kind of experience? The same kind of experience that I have in a gallery looking at a painting. So I tried to capture it with that image. I get fascinated with texture.
Well, those are a kind of image that you really can get fascinated with.
These?
The peeling paint.
Peeling paint is... I think they're...
I mean, a person on a house, the outside of a house, you don't want it peeling. But that's for a different reason.
That's right. And I mean...
This is something that happened. And... obviously, in time, it will be changed and erased.
Exactly. And some of the things that, like when I look at these things, I like the idea of incidental color juxtapositions, right? Where we've painted something one color, then we painted it another color, and as those layers start to break down, nobody ever thought, well, you know, this rusty color is going to look great next to this green color necessarily. It just sort of happened. And I like the idea that it's sort of the world just being allowed to exist and create that experience for us. Maybe not just for us, but it creates that experience and we can see it. And,
but you selected it.
And then I selected it because I saw it and right. It was one of those things that hit me. I said, you know, this is something that some artists strive to create. It's an aesthetic experience that I'm having with the world that I could also have this same experience in a gallery. And that's why I try to capture it, because I see these areas of the world that are like little paintings. And I say, that's my goal. I'm trying to make paintings that refer to these kinds of things. So even when I talk about, you know, non-representational painting, it's hard for me to even think about my paintings in that way, because to me, they represent things like this that sort of happen in the world, juxtapositions of materials, juxtapositions of colors, the way one material sits on top of another material, things like that.
You said you had some other images.
I do.
Okay. Do you want to take a look at a couple of those?
Sure. Let's see what we've got here. These are all sort of similar. We can look at this one. This is a wall with some of my paintings installed on it. This was installed at the Goggle Works a couple of years ago in a show called Collision Cross Section. And these are some of my smaller paintings. Most of these start as little 6-inch by 6-inch paintings. The one in the foreground here is a dipped painting. And I make this canvas and I dip those down into different layers of latex paint and create these experiences, these objects.
Do you ever run out of latex paint?
No. I keep a steady supply coming in. I never run out of it.
Because I know that stores that they've mixed the wrong colors or something like that. They used to give those away years ago.
Now they charge for them.
Now they charge
a minimal amount, but they still charge for them. Yeah. So I use those. I use mistinted paints. I use, you know, whatever I can find.
Do you ever spray any paints on?
I don't usually spray them.
It's very different than dipping.
Dipped paints, one of the reasons I like the dipped paint is because it takes a lot of the artist's sort of signature or handwork out of it. It allows the paint to kind of be paint rather than anything else. And that's, I always try to remove any kind of signature mark. It's impossible to remove it completely, but I think if I'm drawing with it or spraying it, there's something there. I like the material of paint. It's one of the reasons that I became a painter, is because I like the material of paint, and I find it a beautiful object in and of itself. So I look for ways to allow paint to be paint and present itself to the viewer. I just try to facilitate it.
Did you ever take layers of paint and play with that?
Yes. Yeah,
because you can do that with plastic paints particularly, mm-hmm. because they don't break up that easy.
Right, and latex paints, as long as you're using glossier paints, they tend to be more rubbery. They don't crack as much as flatter finishes. You can peel them off of things. As long as it's a nice glossy surface, you can peel them off and bend them and cut them and do all sorts of stuff with them.
Give us one more example.
That's the wall. There we go. That one. This is another work from that same exhibition at the Goggle Works. This is these paint cans on the floor. Each one is filled slightly with a white oil-based paint. And then I have electrical lights hanging from the ceiling into each of these buckets. And each one is a compact fluorescent bulb, one of those twisty bulbs a lot of people call them. And they're all a daylight color. So it creates this kind of blue light within each of those buckets. This piece is actually called First Proposition for the Construction of a Painting in the Post-Historical Age. And this is actually version two. Version one I created in 1999 when I was in undergraduate school. It was three buckets. One was red, one was yellow, one was blue paint. Each had an incandescent light hanging in it. And it was put on a dimmer switch, so it was a very, very low glow out of each one. And it created this very warm sense with each of them. I'm revisiting the same idea with these, but I've changed the format some. It's more of a scattered pattern on the floor rather than a row. They're all the same color. They use these compact fluorescent bulbs, which weren't around in 1999, but I like the idea of them as objects. They're a really beautiful bulb, the way they twist around each other. Again, another time when I saw this object in the world, I said, I could put that on a shelf, on a gallery wall, and it could hold its own. It could be, you know, an art object in and of itself. So how can I incorporate that experience into one of my paintings? And I still consider this a painting, even though it's more of an installation.
Or a sculptor.
Or a sculpture. Yeah. I mean, it's not quite
as... Because it's a physical, three-dimensional.
Right, it doesn't quite create an environment like an installation would, but it is... it sits on the floor, which is nice. When you view it, you look down into the buckets, and there.
Now, I'm talking with Brent here about the project wall at the New Arts Program in Kutztown, and he's working on it for 12 weeks, so it's about 11 more weeks to go.
That's right.
And which is Sunday, July 12th, the reception that we'll have for it at the end, wherever he is at that end. There isn't an end. It can go on and on, actually. But what we're trying to do is see what his ideas are and how he thinks about it, and then taking these ideas and to the form of understanding. You don't have to agree with them. It's just that you understand what he's saying and the concept that he's saying. And then hopefully you will come and view it at some time. And then make another observation. Again, you don't have to agree with it. Just try to understand. There's no value judgment in understanding. That's one of the big problems that people have. We all have that. We see something, and right away, if we understand it, we think we've got the answer. The one and only answer.
Well, there
the truth.
I don't know that there ever is just one answer.
Well, sometimes we...
We'd like to think there is.
We formulate those sometimes. Kind of mindlessly, in a way, I think. I mean, I think it happens most of the time that way, or we just push it off. Give us some other images of that we started out with at the beginning, photographs.
You want to look at more of the photographs?
Yeah.
Here.
Is that Mark?
That is. That's a... It's a sycamore tree.
Okay.
Sycamore trees are beautiful. I've grown to really enjoy looking at them because they constantly change the way they peel their bark off constantly. Sometimes they're green underneath, sometimes they're gray. Again, it's that idea of sort of incidental juxtaposition of color. One color next to another, and these have very little to do with human interaction. These just exist
It happens by nature. It just happens.
Right. They just sort of happen. And just by walking by them and, you know, visiting those small spaces that they have on them, I mean, there's so much depth to that image of what a lot of us say, it's just bark. There's so much depth to it. You were talking about understanding of artwork and sort of understanding sort of my ideas, how I go about constructing art, why I go about constructing art. One of the things that I've realized that I do as I've gone back and looked at art is that I'm always trying to instigate some kind of reaction from the viewer. And most times I'm trying, maybe subconsciously, I think sometimes very consciously, to frustrate the viewer.
Good.
Because I think that from that frustration, the viewer is going to try to interact with the work a little bit more. I think I don't think that it's a good idea all the time to lay out everything in front of somebody and say, here it all is. Look at it and just understand it. There are times when that's great. If you're in a classroom, it's what you want to do. Here it all is and teach someone. With the art, what I try to do is make the viewer do some of the work. I don't want to do all the work for them, because I don't think that you can gain a great understanding of any piece of art without doing some work as the viewer. And what I try to do is point out to the viewer sort of what they're doing, where they are, what their situation is. And I think many of my objects are very minimal objects for that reason, that they give hints at ideas, but they never define anything completely. Because I tend to think that definition is a very sort of slippery or sloppy space. It's hard to rope something and say, this is it. I've defined it completely within these bounds.
You've got the truth.
What's that?
It's a form of truth.
Right, and I don't think that you can do that. I think that there are very few things in the world that aren't affected by outside influence on that definition. If you think about the idea of a chair, we can all understand what a chair is, but a chair, if we weren't told what a chair was, if we didn't understand the usage of a chair, it would just be, we could consider it an art object that doesn't have function except it's sort of an aesthetic function and a experiential function. So the chair is partly defined by our experience of other chairs.
But if you weren't told what a chair was, you might investigate it and find that, well, I can sit in it anyway.
You might.
Or like a bench out there. It doesn't have to be a bench. It could be for other things, too.
Right.
Let's get another image.
Another image? There we go. It's a space. It's a color. It's form. It's objects. It is an aesthetic experience, and that's over and over again. If you continue to look at the images, you'll see that that is what I'm looking at: material, I'm looking at color, I'm looking at how objects sit together. Very, very formalized.
Well, the centerpiece here is the wall.
Yes.
It's almost like the wall, I mean, the image of the tree trunk.
That's right.
Except there's no physicalness to the wall here.
Right. It's a pattern that is...
Yeah, a pattern
on
in some way.
The object itself.
Let's try another image.
Sure.
See, you forgot to point the camera on the object.
Well,
no, I'm just kidding.
Well, and that's exactly. I mean, I like to look at those spaces that we pass by, those spaces that are in the periphery that we don't stop and look at, but that can be a very formal aesthetic experience. The thing that I like about this is that juxtaposition of materials, one material next to another, that is, that's what I enjoy. And when I make objects, I like to push one material up against another, almost like a collage.
When we talk about seeing a tree, we can never see the tree by itself. It's always juxtaposed with something else.
Yes.
Always. Yet we will isolate it in many cases. Or the same with a person that's standing there. In other words, you can't see the person without something else there. So there isn't anything that isn't juxtaposed.
Right.
Which is contrary to the way we sometimes read things.
We think about things as singularities. This is an object, and it's all I'm looking at is that one object.
I guess that could be done with the eye, but I know that being having hearing aids, that hearing aids are different than the hearing of an ear.
Right.
Because somehow the ear can bring in to focus hearing elements and push off hearing elements. But a hearing aid does not discriminate.
Right. And I mean, that's...
It shows every sound at the same blast.
It's what the eye does. The eye scans, finds points of interest, and focuses on them. And...
Do you think part of that is the mind, too, that's
certainly.
Helping with the focus?
Certainly.
And because you don't because you see a hell of a lot out there.
That's right. And it goes back to what I was talking about with definitions then, that objects can't sit singularly as themselves. They have an environment, whether that's the knowledge of the world around us or whether it's the fact that an object sits in a physical space. It can't be defined on its own.
Let's see another one more. Is that concrete or is that a wall or is that?
That's a road.
A road.
So it's asphalt.
That's been painted on with a divide where parking space
that's
or
right.
something. It's got a crack in it, though.
It's got a crack in it.
It's got to be repaired.
it's a tough winter.
That's the way. Yeah.
But it's another one of those things. It's a space that is often overlooked. You can see that there's more than one layer of white on there. There's three or four different kinds of white. And it just creates that experience, you know, like that juxtaposed color, one color on top of another. Not necessarily, nobody was thinking about, well, you know what, if I use a different white next year to repaint this, it's going to look even better. And you're just slapping it on there to get the job done.
Well, this is, again, is something that happens in nature.
That's right.
In almost all of your images, it has something of that in common, don't they? It's sort of a natural phenomena in a
right.
way.
I mean,
because you're selecting it out.
Right.
Of it. Even the first one, which was light, you're selecting it. But still,
There's that, that element
there's an environment.
Of nature in it. Yeah, definitely.
Okay, now just one more image.
Okay.
Just one more.
I don't know if there's a... Oh, it's back to one of those.
Back to... Now, this leads me to the last question that I have for you, and that is, how could anyone get involved with what you have that you have presented as far as your work on the project wall? Because you're opening it to everyone or to anyone.
They can get involved. They can go to the gallery and scan one of these QR codes. That will take them into that virtual space. They can go to Facebook, to Twitter, or to Instagram.
What do they do on that to get?
They would have to search for... They can search for the hashtag 7th Proposition on any of those three.
Or use your name.
Or they could use my name, at least on Facebook.
Brent Collins?
7th Proposition would be a better one.
Better one, huh?
Yeah. 7th Proposition will take you to any of those three accounts, no matter which outlet you
or
wanted to
Or any other in. Ones that you would set up.
And we'll or anything else that I would set up.
Yes.
So they could approach it from either direction, either through the gallery or going directly to those social media outlets.
Okay. Anything else that we missed that we can help access? It seems so simple.
It is. It's a very simple way to access it.
Okay, Brent, thank you.
Thank you.
I'd like to thank the audience for tuning in. I'm James Carroll, and good night. New Arts Alive is produced through Berks Community Television and can be seen live on the second Tuesday of each month at 5 p.m. Consult your local community cable service for live and repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts program and its consultation residencies of artists from the literary, visual, and performing arts, call 683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530. Or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown, PA. Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5, Saturday, 10 to 2, or by appointment.